and harmed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. So he is Allah who is one, Allah the eternal refuge. He neither begets nor is born, nor is there to him any equivalent.
طيب, here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ. And this surah is known as Surah Al Ikhlas. And along with Al Kafirun, Surah Al Kafirun, which we just talked about, they are called Suratay Al Ikhlas, the two surahs of Ikhlas. The two surahs of Ikhlas. This surah is dedicated to the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's nothing else in this surah except for the description of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is ikhlas purely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as it relates to his description. And that is that Allah azza wa jalla is the one. He is unmatched. He is unrivaled. He is peerless as it relates to his names and his attributes and his actions and his essence, subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is nothing like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing that is equal to him. So he is one. And when they say one, that is what the one means here. Peerless. There's nothing like him subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has no rival, he has no match, no equal, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why this surah is called Surah Al-Ikhlas, because it contains the tawheed, what is known as tawheed al-ma'rifati wal-ithbat. That is to single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the affirmation of these attributes. And the affirmation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's lordship and his names and his attributes, that Allah azza wa jalla is single in that and he has no partner. As for Surah Al-Kafirun, which is the other Surah Al-Ikhlas, then it contains what is Tawheed Al-Ibadah. That is that worship is purely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and that no one else deserves that worship. No idol, no star, no saint, no pious person, no anything deserves that worship. And so that is why these two surahs contain both types of tawheed, that is tawheed al-ibadah and tawheed al-ma'rifati wal-ithbat. The tawheed that is singling out Allah azza wa jalla in worship and singling out Allah azza wa jalla as the only one whom these attributes are affirmed to in terms of one's creed. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to read these two surahs in Raka'atay al-Fajr, that is the two sunnahs before Salat al-Fajr. And he also used to read them at the end of his witr. Sabbih ismi rabbika al-a'la, qul ya ayyuhal kafirun, qul huwallahu ahad. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is also reported to have read them in the sunnahs that are after Maghrib, but this is not authentic. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as it comes in Sahih Muslim on the authority of Jabir, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed them after making tawaf. Even though there is some discrepancy in that wording. But the point is, here as Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to begin his day, he used to begin his day with these two surahs, and he would end his night with these two surahs. So he would end al-witr with these two surahs and begin his day before Salat al-Fajr, praying the sunnahs of Fajr with these two surahs, because of what they contain of tawheed. Al-bara'atu min ash-shirk, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said about Surah Al-Kafirun, to free yourself, disassociate from shirk, and to declare that that worship is for Allah azza wa jalla alone, and to worship him alone, and as it relates to one's creed. Likewise, Surah Al-Ikhlas, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when a man came to him and he said, I heard one of the companions, he said that I heard someone else, yani another companion, reciting this surah, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ يُرَدِّدُهَا. He just kept repeating it all night. It was as if he saw it to be blameworthy. So he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he told him about it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِ بِيَدِي إِنَّهَا تَعْدِلُ ثُلُثَ الْقُرْآنِ. By the one in whose hand my soul is in, indeed, it is equivalent to a thuluth, a third of the Quran. The Prophet ﷺ said to his companions, أَيَعْجِزُ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يَقْرَأَ ثُلُثَ الْقُرْآنِ فِي لَيْلَةٍ Is one of you not have the ability to read a third of the Quran in the night? And they said, which one of us has the ability to do that, O Messenger of Allah? He said, Al-Ahadu Samad, Al-Wahidu Samad, Thuluthul Quran. Al-Wahidu Samad, Thuluthul Quran. The one, the eternal sustainer is a third of the Quran, meaning Surah Al Ikhlas is a third of the Quran. And likewise, the Prophet ﷺ used to recite Qul Huwallahu Ahad along with Qul A'udhu Bi Rabbil Falaq or Qul A'udhu Bi Rabbil Nas before going to bed at night. As Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha reported that when the Prophet ﷺ would go to his bed, he would recite these three surahs. And he would put his hands like this. She said he would gather his hands like this. And he would nafath, yanfuth. That is to blow, but with a small amount of moisture coming out, not spitting and not just blowing air, but with a small amount of moisture coming out such that the tongue is maybe here and one goes like that, such that, and then when he would finish
Oh.
So the Prophet والسلام, would gather his hands as such, and he would blow into them with some moisture, and then he would read those, or he would read those three surahs, Qul Huwallahu Ahad, and the Mu'awwidhatayn, Qul A'udhu bi Rabbil Falaq, Qul A'udhu bi Rabbin Nas, and then he would blow into his hands, and then he would start with the top of his head and come down over his face, and then the front of his body, and wipe what he could from the back of his body. The only place that it is legislated to do this is when reading the three Qul Huwallahu Ahad, Qul A'udhu bi Rabbil Falaq, Qul A'udhu bi Rabbin Nas, before going to sleep. Any other time, it is not legislated to do that. After Salat, some people make dua and they wipe over themselves like that, or any other time. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the only time it's reported that he did that was with these three surahs before going to bed, and he would read them three times. He would do that action three times. And so we, as followers of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, should do this. Everybody has memorized these surahs. We should do this and not be lazy before going to sleep, because as the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, and I guess I'm going to be explaining the three of these surahs together because of the time that remains, ما تعوذ متعوذ بمثلهما, that there is no one who has sought protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the likes of قل والله أحد عفوان قل أعوذ برب الفلق قل أعوذ برب الناس. And so one should protect himself. This is something that also the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam encouraged. So these are, you read these three before going to sleep. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam also encouraged some of the companions. It's been narrated in an authentic hadith that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam encouraged them to say it in the morning and in the day, in the morning and in the evening. يعني من أذكار الصباح والمساء. يعني when you're making your أذكار, or the supplications and the remembrances of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala that you make in the morning and in the evening, that you also recite Allah with that, قل والله أحد قل أعوذ برب الفلق قل أعوذ برب الناس. Likewise, there was a man who the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam sent out with a group of his companions, and he used to lead them in the salat. And when he would pray, he would recite قل والله, he would recite Al-Fatiha and then another surah, and then at the end he would recite قل هو الله أحد. يعني that is after the other surah. And so they thought that this was strange. And so they went to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and he told them, ask him, why is he reciting Qul Huwallahu Ahad after these other surahs that he's reciting? And he said, because inna fiha sifat ar-Rahman, that it contains the attributes and the description of ar-Rahman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so I love to read it. And so the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, inform him that Allah loves him. So this surah is a great surah that we should recite, and we should understand the meanings. Qul Huwallahu Ahad, as we already mentioned, he is one. He is Allah, he is one. Peerless, unique, he has no match and no equal. Allahu Samad. The scholars have said different things about the meanings of a Samad, but all of it goes back, it boils down to one thing. And that is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the self-sufficient. He is the independent of all need, the one whom all turn to for their needs. This is, and so this is why they translate it as the eternal, because he is al-Baqi, he is the one who will always exist and has always existed. He is the eternal and he is the sustainer. So everyone turns to him for their needs. لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ, يعني he does not begit nor was he begotten. He was not born. Rather, he is Allah. الْأَوَّلَ الَّذِي لَيْسَ قَبْلَهُ شَيْءٍ. He is the first, that which there is none that came before him. سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. So he was not born. He didn't come from anything. He is the first. There is nothing that came before him. And as some of the scholars used to say, anything that is born will die. And Allah is the الْحَيِّ الَّذِي لَا يَمُوتُ. He is the one that is alive and will never die. سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. وَلَمْ يُولَدْ. And he did not give birth to anything. لَمْ يَلِدْ. يعني he didn't give birth to anything. وَلَمْ يُولَدْ. And he was not born himself. So Allah Azza wa Jalla doesn't have any children. تَعَالَى اللَّهُ عَنْ ذَلِكَ. يعني he is above that. سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. Above having any children. مَتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ مِنْ وَلَدٍ وَمَا كَانَ مَعَهُ مِنْ إِلَهٍ. Allah did not take any children, nor is there any deity with him. سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى بِدِيرُ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. He is the creator, the originator of the heavens and the earth. أَنَّ يَكُونُ لَهُ وَلَدٌ وَلَمْ تَكُنْ لَهُ صَاحِبَةٌ. How can he have a child when he doesn't have a companion? He doesn't have a wife or partner. سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. ahad, and there is nothing that is equal to him. Ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu said, this is the same meaning as laysa kamithlihi shay, that there is nothing like unto him subhanahu wa ta'ala. As for the mu'awwidatayn, that is kul huwallahu, kul a'udhu bi rabbil falaq, and kul a'udhu bi rabbin nas, then I will give a very brief tafsir or explanation as to the ability that we have within the next 4 minutes, inshallah ta'ala. We already mentioned some of the virtue of the surahs, and that they should be recited before going to sleep and in the morning and in the daytime, and that the Prophet ﷺ said that no one has sought refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with anything that is better than these two surahs. And this is why we know that they are Madinan surahs, because the Prophet ﷺ, as it comes in some of the narrations, he used to seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the ayn, yani from the evil eye of the jinn and the ins. And likewise, he used to place Al-Hassan and Hussein, his grandchildren, under the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the likes of these dua until these two surahs were revealed, and then he would use them, and he would not use anything else. So when we want to seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we should use these surahs. People shouldn't be scared of da'ain, be scared of al-hasid, be scared of these things, be scared of jinn, be scared. No, we're not scared of that. We seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from that, and then Allah azza wa jalla is the one who protects. But the problem is people become scared because they don't use these remedies. They don't take precautions. And so instead of taking precaution, they want someone, they're going to go find someone that's a raqi. Can we find someone to read over Fulan? Why does Fulan need to be read over in the first place? Because, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, but in most cases, someone is negligent in their duty to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and careless when it comes to reciting these surahs. So we should, because anybody can go back and read the translations, I want to focus on how do we act according to these surahs. How do we act? We need to implement these in our lives. We need to make them part of our lives, not be careless when it comes to those prophetic medicines that the Prophet ﷺ has prescribed for us. If the doctor gave you a prescription, you're the first one to make sure that you check your watch every 8 hours and make sure that you do it exactly when the doctor said take it. If he said before a meal, it's before a meal. If it's after a meal, you don't do it until after the meal. But the Prophet ﷺ has given us better than that. He has given us that which will allow us bi-idhnillah, divine protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but still we are careless and heedless when it comes to these protections that have been offered and have been explained by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As for the meanings, then very quickly, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ, يعني you are seeking refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And refuge, we know the word refugee. Many people leave their countries because they're facing political, you know, torture and these type of things, and they go to another place and they are called a refugee, because they are seeking refuge in that place. Well, here you are fleeing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, asking Him for His protection, seeking refuge in Allah azza wa jal. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ, the Lord of the daybreak, yani the one who is the one who is the Rabb, as we already translated on numerous occasions, the one who created it and sustains it. Min sharri ma khalaq, so you seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the evil of all of the creation, whether that is jinn or shayateen or mankind or from the animals or from yourself. So you seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from everything that has been created. That is general, and then there are some specifics. Wa min sharri ghasiqin idha waqab, yani you seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the night as it approaches. And that is because many people do their dirt in the nighttime. They want to hide under the cover of the darkness, along with the shayateen and other than that. So if you were to take any type of survey, you would see that the crime that happens at night is more than crime that happens in the daytime. And then the Prophet, and then Allah Azza wa Jalla instructs us, وَمِن شَرِّنَّ فَتَاتِ فِي الْعُقَدِ, and to seek refuge in the female sorcerers when they blow in the knots. And that is a whole discussion of as-sihr, but we are the sorcery. So in this surah, we are taught to seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the effects of sorcery, from sorcery itself and from its effects. And also from the min sharri hasidin idha hasad, and from the evil of the one who envies at the time of his envying. And here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specify at the time that he is envying, because there is no one in general that is free from having some type of envy. But he pushes it away because of his iman in al-qada wal-qadr. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.